This is the bike we rebuilt the top end on not too long ago, or sort of half rebuilt it. It didn't have great compression, and you may recall a new piston and piston rings solved that problem. It's been doing a lot better. The engine is happier, but all that raw power, those unbridled 2.5 horsepower the engine is putting out, are getting lost somewhere along the way. I think there's something up with the clutch. And if my calculations are correct, it should be in here. I don't actually have new clutch parts if I do end up finding a problem, but this exercise is more of an exploration, an expedition maybe. Let's see what we find and what we can do with what we got, if anything at all. I know some of you don't like motorbike videos, and some of you love them. I hope you see the pickle that puts me in. Let me take this pack out. We'll have a close look at it on the bench. Geez, how many discs does this thing have? 6. It's got 6 discs. Well, 6 friction discs. The reason the bike's leaning over on its side is so all the oil doesn't come pouring out. All right, I'm gonna need just a minute to make some bench space. Next video, if all goes well, will be a Maho update. I'm slowly putting the mill back together, cleaning things up as I go along, waiting for one or two other parts. Though, sneak peek, maybe I already said this, the drives came in and the motors are turning under Mach control. Is that awesome or what? These things are so nice. I may have just peed a little bit. Multiplate clutches. Don't let that name intimidate you. Multiplate is simply short for multiple plates. Let's talk about them just a minute. Now, I heard all those eye rolls. Those of you out there that already know what's going on here, take a moment to think of the kids, would you? You recall this electromechanical clutch we saw a couple of videos ago? It had a splined input side and a splined output side. And power couldn't move through this until the cute little toothed face gear thing was engaged. You might have a motor on one side, spinning this all the time like crazy, and whatever you want connected to the other side, just sitting there not moving. One side spins, the other side doesn't, until you give it the green light. The toothed wheel slides over, connects the two, and now you have power from your motor to your blender or whatever is attached to the driven end. This is the same thing, only smooshed really, really flat. These are the input splines, these little lugs on the outside, just like this other clutch. And here are the output splines, or lugs, again, just like the other side of this clutch. The outside ones can turn freely without moving the inside ones, unless the clutch is doing its thing. Then they all spin together. You could consider this an axial clutch, transferring torque along its axis. And this one may be a radial clutch, transferring torque from the outside to the inside radically. I mean, radially. Instead of that toothed face gear on the electromechanical clutch, the bike clutch works on friction. Again, there are friction plates with all these little brake pad looking things. And then there are smooth steel, sometimes aluminum plates, like a smooth disc brake. And the brake pads work against the brake disc. And there's quite a few of them, 6 pairs it looked like. So if you were to quote unquote stomp on the brakes, push this whole pack together, torque on the outer splines, the outer lugs, is transferred to torque on the inner splines, the inner lugs. And where does that torque come from? I have no idea. The clutch basket. Basket may just be the outside bit, I'm not totally sure. But there are 2 parts, an outer housing and an inner housing. This might be the hub, maybe. They're not connected. The clutch plates are what bridge those 2 parts. Hold on, I left them over at the bench. The steel plates with the internal lugs, the internal spline, key up to the clutch hub, so they're connected to the middle. The friction discs have no lugs on the inside, only the outside, and they interface with the clutch hub. The outer bit, again the basket I think, is connected to the engine. Hit the kickstarter. It spins along with the engine. it's turning anytime the engine is running. And the clutch hub in the middle is currently connected to nothing because the bike isn't in gear. But if you put it in gear, the transmission connects it to the rear wheel, and no power is transmitted unless all the clutch plates are smashed together. When you let go of the clutch lever up on the handlebars and the clutch pack is closed, all those little brake pads are pushing on the brake disc. Power flows from the engine through the clutch to the rear wheel, driving you face first right into a tree or a rock maybe. Notice how I said when you pull the lever in. This clutch is arranged backwards to the electromechanical clutch. This engine is always connected to the wheel until you pull the lever to disengage them. In this little clutch, the load was never connected to the motor unless you pushed a button or something, sent power to the ring gear. So how on earth do you get a clutch to work only when you're not doing something? Well, we'll talk about that later when we put this back together. For now, let's go have a very close look at the, just like brake pads or a box of donuts, these things don't last forever. They're a consumable item. The friction material or the steel plates wear, glaze over, and you get less and less power transfer through the clutch. If your brakes slip, they're not going to stop your car. If your clutch slips, it's not going to move your bike. Of course, it's not all or nothing. You can have a worn clutch that transfers some power, just like you might have poopy brakes. I've printed a couple of pages from the shop manual for this bike. Fortunately, they just happen to be the ones about the clutch discs. These just have some key measurements listed, wear limits, specifications for the minimum thickness of the friction discs, and minimum dimension of like the spline or the lugs coming off the perimeter. It says the limit is 2.5 millimeters. Mine all measure 2.7 and change, 2.75 and up. Thickness-wise, they're still in spec. I was really expecting to find worn discs or plates, though they don't look particularly glazed or cooked to me. So what I think I'm going to do is simply clean these up a bit, maybe give them a bit of a razzing on some sandpaper. I assume that can only help, and then we'll also take a close look at the clutch basket itself. Yeah, I'm just kidding. This is 600 grit sandpaper. 800 would have probably been better. This should be fine. But it's important to know I'm doing almost nothing. I'm not trying to sand these down. I'm not trying to flatten them. The goal of this is to just sort of scuff that surface up. The next step, washing and cleaning, arguably is more important than this. Left to my own devices, I'd be doing this on a surface plate. Instead, I've just spray mounted some sandpaper to a piece of thick glass. It's come to my attention that not everyone has a surface plate at home. But I mean, come on, can you really consider that a home? Next, I'm just gonna give them a good scrubbing with a new stainless steel brush. I've got just some water and a little bit of dish detergent in there. This brake material, this friction material, is porous. It's like a cork or something. I don't know what they put on there. I'm just trying to knock out any debris that may have become embedded. I think this is why they call these wet clutches. This would probably be a lot easier in some sort of container big enough to let you scrub the discs underwater. Though, frankly, you could probably do this dry. This is just maybe keep the dust down. And perhaps here you can see the difference between one I just scrubbed and one that I haven't. Granted, this isn't a great comparison as this thing is still all oily and has stuff on it from the sandpaper. While I've got you in here this close, some people like to go to the trouble of cleaning out sort of all this glue between the friction material. I hear it helps if you have things like a sticky clutch, you know, when you first start the bike up after it's been sitting for a couple of days. I'm not going to go to all this trouble, but maybe you're more into clutches than I am. It took me 2.5 podcasts, but I managed to clean up the whole pack. I don't know if I actually did anything positive, but I'm happy with how they turned out. Now for kicks, this is how I get my kicks. I wire brushed a few of these dry, and if I'm being honest, that worked perfectly fine. Definitely less sloppy, though it did stink, like it smelled. These things certainly kick up a lot of dust. I've also concluded that the sandpaper was probably a complete waste of time. The wire brush, with enough elbow grease, seems to break up the surface just fine. The steel plates I Scotch-brighted. Now, I haven't done this to a clutch pack in probably 15 years, and here's hoping it'll be another 15 before it ever dawns on me again. Not fun. 2 out of 5 stars. Would not recommend. As I'm prone to do, I've jumped the gun a little and removed the clutch basket from the bike. Is that a pretty piece of engineering or what? I noticed something while taking the pack out that I'd like to address. But first, a bit of a backstory. The clutch pack, if I can get this aligned, fits in here like so. The hub would be on the inside, of course, and there's a pressure plate that closes this whole thing up. The plate with the springs you might remember from earlier. In here, the clutch pack expands and contracts, opens and closes, slides in these slots, transmitting torque when it's compressed, when it's closed, or not transmitting torque when it's open. And let this be the last time I have to tell you this. These lugs are what pick up the engine power coming from these gears and transmit it to the wheel. Stay with me. This is important. Without any pressure on the clutch pack, the steel plates can rotate. You know, all of them would rotate. They're keyed to the hub. So the hub rotates. They drive the hub. Until you push this whole pack down. And then friction is helping you out. Nothing can move relative to each other. And the whole thing moves as one piece. Remove the pressure and the inner hub can slip. Anyway, here's what I noticed. If I get these clutch pack out. Take a look inside of these slots where the friction discs interface with this basket, where the basket is pushing the discs that then push the steel plates that then pushes the hub. Do you see all those little lumps in there? I hope you do, because from where I'm sitting, I can't. Little wear spots where each friction plate would make contact. There should be six, maybe bright spots. Those aren't good. They wouldn't cause the lack of power I think I'm seeing in this bike, but they would make for a very poor clutching experience. Those could cause the plates to not be silky smooth as they expand and contract. The result is a jerky clutch. You pull the lever, the pressure comes off the pack, but the plates might be stuck in those little valleys so they don't open quickly or as effortlessly as they should. Now, what you're seeing here isn't too bad, but if it were much worse, you'd have to replace this clutch basket. I'm going to try to lightly draw file those out. They're a little deeper on the drive side, but there's not very much to do here. Again, luckily here it's very subtle. I don't know if this really makes a difference, but I want to keep at least my finishing strokes in the direction that the pack moves. I'm happy with how that turned out. I gave this a quick wash. I'm going to scrub it down a little bit better. There's still a bunch of junk in here. But I think it's ready to go back together. Again, the point of what we just did was remove any resistance to these clutch discs sliding in and out. If you happen to be a real hardcore clutch enthusiast, you could probably also polish the mating surfaces on all the lugs on each of the friction discs. That, or I suppose you could buy good quality clutch plates to begin with. On inspection, there are bright spots. Yep, there's bright spots on the mating faces of each one of these. But I mean, come on, what are the odds of all of these faces contacting at the same time? Sooner or later, probably within 10 minutes of riding your bike, these surfaces will probably move around until they settle into their new home. That said, I can't tell you how strong the temptation is to walk these over to the filing machine, give each one of those lugs a quick lick. Of course, while you have it apart, the same goes for the hub. Again, this is where the steel plates interface. Because of the torque they're pushing, these grooves would get the same sort of pitting. I don't know if you can see that in the light. I can't really feel them under my fingers, so I'm just gonna leave this one alone. But again, if it gets too bad, you'd have to replace this part too. Let me give these a good washing and we'll... Two things the service manuals don't tell you when you're reinstalling a clutch. First, try to get as much dog hair out as possible. You won't get it all, but the more you get out of there, the better. Second, do your darndest not to hit the tripod. I don't remember 100% how these parts came out. There's probably a torque spec for this thing. That should be about it. And this is the push rod, I think. When you pull the clutch lever, this is the thing you're working on. That's the rod you're pushing against. If yours has an odd number of plates or an odd number of friction discs, make sure you put them in the way they came out. If there was a friction disc on the outside, make sure there's a friction disc on the outside and not a steel plate. And this here is the pressure plate. If I pull the clutch now, that entire plate translates. And what holds that down are these springs. These springs keep the clutch pack closed, keep the engine always connected to the wheel. There's also a length spec for these. These are just borderline. Over time, they'll shorten and you should replace them. Some folks like to install stiffer springs, different clutch feel. Some people only install some percentage of the springs the factory put in there for a lighter clutch pull. Maybe add some washers, that sort of thing. The only thing to be careful of, you don't want to make the clutch pull so light that when the pack is fully closed, there's not enough pressure via this pressure plate to keep that clutch from spinning or slipping. There's one more thing I wanted to try out here. And that's the end play on this push rod. Hopefully you can see that it's moving a little bit. There's some backlash, I guess, in there before it engages the pressure plate. I'm just teasing the clutch lever. If I pull it all the way, it'll lift the pressure plate. You don't want that end play to be too much, but you need some there. Yeah, it's probably borderline. Doesn't seem too bad. If it were, you'd take the pressure plate off again and add another shim between the pressure plate and this push rod. Either replace the one that's there with a thicker one or add another 5/10 thou, whatever you think you need. Now comes the absolute worst part of this entire endeavor. Trying to get this super thin O-ring to stay in place while we get that cover on. Sounds easy, doesn't it? This is going to take me the rest of the morning. Probably means I need a new O-ring. I think that does it. Even though I don't know exactly what it is, not sure if we fixed anything, to be honest. At least not until I take it for a spin. But I'm pretty sure we didn't make anything worse. And in the end, isn't that what really matters? I appreciate you sticking around. Hope that helps someone. Thanks for watching.